we are now able to read input through our player input class, which makes it almost possible for us to start moving our player. Almost, because we still need to set a few small things before we are able to do it. The first one is of course adding a rigid body. Without it, our physics-based movement won't work. That's quite simple to do. We just select our player game object and add a new component of type rigid body. You could of course use the required component here as well if you'd like. We now have a rigid body, which means our player can move using physics. But it also needs a collider. This is because if we go ahead and enter play mode, our player will start falling due to gravity but won't collide with the ground. To add one, exit play mode and add a new capsule collider component to the player. If we inspect the player, we can see that our capsule collider is more like a sphere. The reason why is that we are not adding it to the character model, but to an empty game object, which doesn't really have a defined size. We'll have to get the character model height ourselves and then define the values of this capsule collider. The way we know our character model size is by using its mesh renderer bound size variable. I've already got it myself and I know that my character model has a height of 1.8. So we'll select the player game object again and give our capsule collider a height of 1.8. Of course, we do have a new problem here, which is the capsule collider being halfway into the ground. That's actually correct as it's centered in the origin. But because we need it to fit our character model, instead of moving the character model object down, we'll update the center of our capsule collider to go up. We simply need it to go up half of the height of the collider, which is 0.9. It shall now be in the correct height, but is still looking quite thick, so let's lower the radius to be around 0.2. If we now enter play mode, our player shall no longer fall through the ground. Of course, if we were to rotate it a bit, which can also happen when we collide with another object, it will fall as we are not restricting any rotations. To fix that, exit play mode and in the rigid body component, open up the constraints area and freeze all rotations. We'll also set interpolate to interpolate and collision detection to continuous for our player. Interpolation removes some possible jittering, while collision detection makes it so our player detects other colliders better, which makes it less likely to go through those colliders. These are recommended to use on your player, but most often only there as they are less performant. That's basically it, but we'll need a reference of our rigid body to be able to use it. So go to the player script, and when you are here, add a new public property of type rigid body, to which I'll name rigid body. I'll give it a private set. Then in the awake method, type in rigid body equals to get component of type rigid body. We now have every required component to move our player, but we don't really have a way to access that player in our states. Thankfully, that's quite easy to do as we just need to pass in our player to the state machine constructor. We have two options here. Pass it in into the state machine and then into each state, which makes it so we can access a variable right away, or leave it in the state machine itself so that we can access to the state machine variable. I don't really see any worthy advantage in any of them besides in one not needing to type in state machine before the player variable and in the other one not needing to pass in the player to the state's constructors. Other than that, it should really be the same. I'll leave the player reference in the state machine as I'm going to use a state machine to hold reusable data. So in the player script, go to the state machine initialization and pass in this, which represents the player class. Then in Visual Studio, I'll press Alt Enter and choose Add Parameter to Player Movement State Machine. Our Movement State Machine constructor shall now have a player parameter. Next, create a public property above of type player, to which I'll name player. I'll omit the set as well. When that's done in the constructor, set this player to be the player parameter. Our state machine can now reference the player, but states don't yet have a reference to our state machine. To do that, let's first go to our movement state. In here, add a constructor for this class by typing in public player movement state and accept a parameter of type player movement state machine named player movement state machine. Then create a protected variable above of type player movement state machine named state machine. When that's done, simply set it in our constructor to be the parameter. We now need to generate a constructor for each of our states that inherit from this one. We'll actually do that by going back to our state machine and passing this for each of the constructors. When you are done doing that, press Alt Enter and choose Generate Constructor in State. Do it for all of the four states. With that done, we are finally ready to start moving our player. Our movement logic will stay at the player movement state base class. So start by opening it up. The first thing we want to do is to read the player movement input. We'll save the input value into a variable, so above create a new protected variable of type vector2, which is our input action control type, and I'll name it movement input. Then we'll set its value in our handle input method, so in there call in a new method named readMovementInput. For organization purposes, I'll be adding this method to a new region named mainMethods. I'll go ahead and also add the author methods to a new region named iStateMethods. You don't need to do this if you don't want to, or if you are not using Visual Studio, it's possible that you can do it. In this new method, we'll read our input by typing in movementInput equals to stateMachine.player.input.playerActions, which gets our action map. Through this action map, we can get our actions. Our movement input was named movement, so type in .movement. And to read its value, we use the .readValue method. This method accepts the type of the value we are trying to read, which in our case is the vector2 type. When that's done, let's go to our physicsUpdate method and call in a new method named move. I'll also add it to the main methods region. Inside, start by checking if movementInput equals equals vector2.0. If that's the case, we return as it means we aren't moving. We can now start moving our player in case there is any input. The way we'll do that is quite simple. Whenever there is input, we'll add a force to our player rigid body towards that direction, at a certain speed. We are already reading our input, so let's also create a variable that holds our speed value. So above, create two new variables. Protected float base speed defaulted to 5f and protected float speed modifier defaulted to 1f. The second variable makes it so we can edit our speed without modifying the base speed. Back to our move method, add to the if statement or speed modifier equals equals 0. We can now add a force to our player. To make it more understandable, I'll be creating a new vector3 named movement direction and set it to be equal to a new method named getMovementInputDirection. We'll be returning a new vector3 which simply holds the value of our movement input y variable in the said axis. So type in return new vector 3 movement input.x 0f movement input.y. I'll also be making this method protected and I'll add it to a new region named reusable methods. We now have our movement input in 3D coordinates, as x and z are our 3D horizontal axis. Back to our move method, we'll now get our movement speed by typing in float movement speed equals to get movement speed. Inside, we'll simply return base speed multiplied by speed modifier. I'll also make it protected and add it to the reusable methods region. All that's left to do now is to add a force for our player to move. Now, commonly, what I see in other tutorials is people setting the rigid body velocity variable right away. However, when going into Unity's documentation, they do not recommend doing that and recommend using add force instead. From my experience while doing this system, I found that while that works, I did need to set the velocity variable sometimes. The reason why was because adding a force isn't instantaneous and will only happen in the next physics update, while setting the velocity right away will be an instant change of the force. We'll understand more on the reason why when we get there, but we'll be using the velocity when resetting our velocity or whenever we can have more than one add force running at the same time, and use add force for the remaining forces, as so far it seems to work fine. That of course means our movement will use the add force method. So in our move method, under our movement speed variable, type in statemachine.player.rigidbody.addForce. For the force, we'll pass in movement direction multiplied by movement speed. This adds a force, but right now, by default, Unity is adding a force mode of force, which isn't really what we want. If we take a look at a nice image made by Nothkey that was posted on Reddit, we see that the force mode not only depends on time, but it's also dependent on our player mass. We don't really want that. Besides not caring about our player mass, we don't want it to be time dependent either. We need an instant force that moves our player at the same speed at the start or middle of the input, which leads us to the force mode known as velocity change. Just like it says in the formula, this is the same as velocity plus equals force, which is almost the same as using our velocity variable to add a force, but of course using the add force method, which gets called in the physics update. Note that this is a 3D force mode and as far as I know, this one doesn't exist in 2D, so it's quite possible you'll need to use the velocity variable instead. Do note that it's also apparently not recommended to use delta time while setting a velocity. Now that we know that, pass in forceMode.velocityChange as the second parameter of the addForce method. It might seem that we are done, but remember that the addForce method adds a force to the already existing force. This means that if we move our player and don't stop pressing our input keys, our player will become Speedy Gonzales. To fix that problem, we simply need to remove the existing velocity from the force we are going to be adding. To do that, type in, just before adding the force, vector 3, current player horizontal velocity equals to get player horizontal velocity. Inside of this new method, create a new vector 3 named player horizontal velocity and set it to be statemachine.player.rigidbody.velocity. Then set the player horizontal velocity.y to be 0f and return the variable at the end. I'll also make this method protected and add it to the reusable methods region. Back to our move method, subtract this horizontal velocity from our force. If we save and go back to Unity, entering play mode should have our player moving at a constant speed. Remember that we don't need to normalize our input through code, as the input action already does that automatically for us. That's the base of our player movement done. But just as a small tip, let's say we were to add another float to our add force multiplication. While this might seem normal at first glance, because our first variable in the multiplication is a vector, it means that it will multiply with movement speed and return another vector, and then multiply with this new variable, which also returns a vector. The problem here is that we are doing two vector multiplications, which are less performant than normal multiplications. If we were, for example, to swap the order and make our vector the last variable, we will now multiply the new float with movement speed, which will just be a normal float multiplication, and only then multiply by our vector, which will be a vector multiplication. We now have one vector multiplication only instead of two, which means it's more optimized. This can be a problem when you are calling the multiplication multiple times, like we are doing for our add force. It will be even worse if it was in the update method, as it's called once per frame. Adding the vector as the last value of the multiplication basically ensures you only have one vector multiplication, unless of course you have more vectors in the formula. In our example, we will now have 10 vector multiplications instead of 20 in 10 calls, just by swapping the order. This doesn't really matter for our system, as we are only multiplying by one value. But it might be a nice thing for you to keep in mind in case you ever multiply vectors by multiple float values. In our case though, we can leave the current order.